Hello students, this is Jayappa speaking on the topic solid oxide fuel cell. In our previous class, we did discuss something about basic concepts of fuel cells. There we studied first the definition of fuel cells, representations of fuel cell, what are the various reactions taking place at the fuel cell, what are the differences between conventional cell and a fuel cell. And then in the previous class, we studied construction and working of methanol oxygen fuel cell. There we studied somewhat in detail about it, its working. Moving on today, that is all about the solid oxide fuel cell. In this session, we are studying somewhat in detail is about solid oxide fuel cell. It is widely known as SOFC. So solid oxide fuel cell, it is also a fuel cell, which converts chemical energy contained in the readily available fuel into electrical energy using a suitable oxidant, that is oxygen. And this type of fuel cell actually differs from rest of the fuel cells in the sense that it is making use of the solid oxide material as the electrolyte. So this is its this is where it stands out from the rest of the fuel cells, that electrolyte used is a solid oxide material. So this is very, very important, hence the name solid oxide. So electrolyte is a solid oxide material, and whenever electrolyte is whenever we speak about electrolyte, electrolyte should be capable of conducting some ions. Correct? No, if you are saying, when we say sulfuric acid is electrolyte, so through which H plus ions can move, or any other ions, sulfate ions, H plus ions, they can move from one region to another region. So here in solid oxide material, what is that ion which is capable of moving from one region to another region, that is oxide ion. So it is capable of conducting oxide ions from cathode to anode. So the ions which are moving from cathode to anode here, that is O2 minus. Now let us see the schematic picture of that is fuel, solid oxide fuel cell. In this fuel cell, just like what we discussed in methanol oxygen fuel cell, instead of methanol, here we are introducing the hydrogen or carbon monoxide. So here there is a fuel flexibility. Either you can use hydrogen as the fuel or carbon monoxide as the fuel. And this fuel is to be introduced through the top inlet like this. So these are the electrodes. This is anode and this is a cathode. In the previous class also, thoroughly discussed about all these things. So when fuel gets inside, this hydrogen gas that gets deposited on the electrode here, that is anode, or gets adsorbed on the anode. And at the cathode, we are constantly supplying oxygen, that is O2 gas, that is oxygen gas molecules get adsorbed on the cathode. So anode and cathode materials, in fact, they are made up of a strong compounds, that is because this fuel cell operating temperature is very, very high. So we have to choose such materials as anode and cathode which can withstand that high temperature. Now anode, if you are taking nickel zirconium oxide or cobalt zirconium oxide, cermet. So cermet is something like it is a ceramic material which is the which has the capacity to withstand very high temperature. So it is something like a composite material, that is nickel zirconium oxide or cobalt zirconium oxide. Cathode is also a strong material that is made up of strontium doped lanthanum manganate. The parent compound is lanthanum manganate, where strontium is added in smaller quantity. Now electrolyte, it is a mixture of yttria and zirconia. The electrolyte is nothing but yttria and zirconia. It is a combination of these two. Yttria, it is actually yttrium oxide. It is stabilized by the addition of zirconium oxide, that is also known as zirconia. So yttrium oxide is Y2O3, zirconium oxide is ZrO2. And there is a fuel flexibility I was speaking, because this kind of fuel cell, it can make use of either hydrogen or carbon monoxide as a fuel, but commonly used oxidizing agent is the same is being used here as oxidant. But operating temperature is very high because I mean only at high temperatures this kind of fuel cells operate. We have to choose such materials which can bear this kind of a temperature. That is why the materials are quite different here. And as this was discussed, and what happens is when hydrogen gas is supplied here at the anode, first they get adsorbed on the anode and then they come in contact with the oxide ions, because here we are keeping the electrolyte. The electrolyte is capable of conducting oxide ions. So some oxide ions will be there in the electrolyte. These oxide ions will be reacting with hydrogen, and as a result hydrogen forms water with the oxide ions, releasing electrons. So electrons will be moving in the external circuit, and water, whatever it is formed, that can be drained out from the bottom outlet. And then electrons which are coming from the external circuit, they reach the cathode, where oxygen is constantly supplied, and oxygen getting adsorbed on the cathode, reacting with the electrons, and it gets reduced, and here oxygen is getting reduced to oxide ions, and these oxide ions they are moving through the electrolyte. That is because your oxide ions you are not taking out. These oxide ions are capable of conducting through the electrolyte, and then they reach the anode, where hydrogen reacts with that oxide ions, forming water, liberating electrons. This is a continuous reaction taking place. Ultimately the reaction is hydrogen reacting with the oxygen, forming water. In other words, when we look at the chemical reactions, we feel as such that hydrogen undergoes combustion to form water. It is not a direct combustion, but indirect combustion, converting chemical energy present in the fuel into electrical energy. So hydrogen that is supplied at the anode, reacting with the oxide ions of the electrolyte, and then water is formed with the release of electrons. These electrons are moving in the external circuit. They reach the cathode, where oxygen is supplied. Oxygen reacts with the electrons, getting reduced to oxide ions. So overall reaction becomes hydrogen reacting with oxygen to give water. If you are using carbon monoxide as the fuel, that also reacts with the oxide ion of the electrolyte, and carbon dioxide is formed with the release of electrons. This carbon dioxide, that escapes because that is a flue gas, and then cathode where oxygen is supplied there, and it reacts with electrons and oxide ions are formed. These oxide ions are moving from cathode to anode, and again the reactions, chain reactions, keep happening. As long as carbon monoxide and oxygen are supplied at the anode and cathode, these reactions keep taking place, ultimately converting all the carbon monoxide into carbon dioxide. This is how the overall reaction takes place. SOFC mainly consists of porous ceramic electrodes. Whatever electrodes we have chosen, they are porous in nature, they are ceramic in nature, and they can withstand very high temperature. Electrodes are separated by a dense oxide ion conducting electrolyte. So we have a oxide ion conducting electrolyte, means that electrolyte contains oxide ions, and it has the ability to make that oxide ions move from one region to another region on the electrolyte surface. The operating principle has already been explained here, and then some of the advantages of this cell. High efficiency, about 95 to 98% of the chemical energy is converted into electrical energy. Long term stability, because we are using a strong anode, cathode, electrolyte, all these materials are quite strong, so no question of undergoing any deterioration. So they have long term stability. And fuel flexibility, either you can use hydrogen as the fuel and carbon monoxide as the fuel. Low emissions, it does not emit harmful combustion gases. Ultimate product is either water or carbon dioxide. And since the operating temperature is quite high, we have to wait till we attain that temperature for the reaction to take place. And the startup times, it will be longer startup times, because of high operating temperature, and so many mechanical and chemical compatibility issues, that is with the materials used as anode and cathode. Okay, So this is all about solid oxide fuel cell. In between there was one diagram. I think it is different diagram which is showing the same reactions. Here these are, this is the top inlet through which hydrogen is let in, and this is the bottom inlet. And hydrogen goes inside, and when it comes in contact with the anode, there from the electrolyte the oxide ions will be reacting with the hydrogen, and hydrogen gets converted into water, and that water will be drained out here and electrons are released. The released electrons are moving in the external circuit and they reach the cathode. Cathode, we are supplying air or oxygen, they will react with electrons and oxide ions are formed. These oxide ions are capable of conducting through the electrolyte and they reach the anode. So whole process takes place like this. Only thing is that we have to ensure that hydrogen is constantly supplied at the anode and oxygen is constantly supplied at the cathode. Then electrons keep moving from anode to cathode, converting all the chemical energy present in the fuel into electrical energy. Okay, I think almost all the points I have explained as far as solid oxide fuel cell is concerned. In case if you have any doubts, anytime you can call and get your doubts clarified. Here the terminologies, some of the terms used, that is especially the material used as anode and cathode and electrolyte also, not very easy to remember. You have to little bit practice well. After studying, you have to make sure that you are in a position to write it without seeing, because whatever you are studying, it is though we say most of the times that you have to study for the knowledge purpose, but then of course when it comes to the examination point of view, you have to write all these things, only then you will fetch marks. And that is why please see that you have understood it first. Having understood, you will be able to write also. That you will make sure, that is by practicing. Okay, let me assume that you are doing all those kinds of practice works. Repetition means repetition of watching this video means again and again watching the video whenever you have some doubts, and getting your doubts clarified, and building confidence on the topic. All these things you will do in the holidays. That is what I believe. Okay, thank you for watching the video, and let us meet again with a new topic in the next video. In the next video, I will be explaining something about solar cells, that is photovoltaic cells. Thank you.